So, ever wanted to make a 3D game, but then you weren't too sure how to make your player avatar move around? From first-person vision in FPS to famous third-person controllers like in so many MMOs and RPGs, or isometric hack-and-slash type of click-based moves? Well, yeah, there's a wide variety of techniques, and here I'm not even thinking of more specific movements or actions like Batman's grappling, Uncharted's ziplines, Dark Souls' dodge rolling, Spider-Man's web-slinging and crawling, parkour and climbing a la Shadow of the Colossus or Assassin's Creed. Well, you get the picture. Moving in games is complex, and it can take many forms, cause moving our player avatar is our most fundamental interaction with the game, and it's therefore one of the key things that can make or break the immersion. So in this video, I want to discuss the three most basic types of 3D movement, so TPS, FPS, and isometric click-based navigation, and give you a quick tour of how to do each in Godot 4 using either GDScript or C#. Oh, and by the way, I'll actually be sharing the full demo scenes on my Patreon, so if you want to play around with those mini prototypes and perhaps extend them further on your own, don't hesitate to check them out over here. Alright, let's get into it, and start with the easiest type of 3D movement in Godot, the third-person RPG-like controller. Now, why is it the easiest? Well, because if you just pick the right node type and use a built-in template, you'll already have an almost working thing in a matter of seconds. What you want to do is use a character body 3D node. I've already talked about it several times on this channel, for example in these videos, and in short, it's a type of physics object in Godot that can detect collisions and is moved via script. This means that typically it isn't subjected to gravity by default, but you can easily add this behavior and then implement player input interaction with just a few lines of code. Cause yeah, don't worry, this character body 3D type has many neat built-ins to help us out. Okay, so basically, if you create your player as a character body 3D node, with a collision shape 3D node inside to define its physical shape, and some 3D mesh or model for the visuals, then you simply need to add a script on this root body node, and make sure you keep the template option enabled with this template selected. This way, you'll instantly get a script for your player that looks like this. Okay, that's already a bit of code. In a nutshell, this script uses the physics process built-in hook to continuously process the body's state and the player inputs, and update the velocity accordingly. The call to move and slide at the end actually applies the velocity and moves the body according to this vector. And the velocity computation is done in three steps. First, we have our player stick or fall down to the floor thanks to gravity. Then we have it jump if we press a specific input action. And finally, we get the horizontal move direction based on a set of four other input actions. So keeping the code as is will give you a basic strafing behavior, where your character doesn't turn, it always faces the same direction, but it does move on the ground and jump properly. If you want to add the rotation, then all you need to do is add two extra lines to compute the rotation direction, and use this value to rotate the character around the vertical y-axis. You'll notice that here I'm also using custom input actions instead of the default ones, and if you're curious about that, I've talked about this concept in this other video. But in any case, there you go! You've now got two versions of a simple third-person controller, either with or without rotation, and of course, depending on whether you parent the camera to your player, it will rotate and follow its movement or not. So, as a little bonus, here's also a script to make your camera translate and keep the player centered without having to parent it to your hierarchy. This way, you should be able to create either one of those three scenarios. Now, the simple strafing third-person controller can actually be transformed quite easily into a FPS version. Indeed, in here for now, the direction our character moves relative to depends on its current rotation around the y-axis. But what if, instead, we used our mouse movements to set this forward direction, as well as the camera, obviously? Then we could basically keep the same code and have our character suddenly move based on our mouse pads. There's, however, a little thing to keep in mind. In FPS view, you don't just look from left to right, you also look up and down. And doing this properly isn't always intuitive, because rotations are actually a pretty complex thing in a 3D game engine, and they can quickly go really crazy. That's an infamous issue called gimbal lock, which in short means that you gradually lose information until you've got no way of knowing what up or right means anymore. To avoid that, the solution is to separate the left-right rotation from the up-down rotation by having two levels in your player hierarchy. You first create a basic node 3D anchor inside your player scene for the head, and then inside you nest the camera 3D that represents your character's eyes. This way, in your script, if you use the built-in input method to get your mouse movements, you can apply the horizontal panning as the left-right rotation on the intermediate head node, and the vertical panning as the up-down rotation on the camera node inside, and thus dodge the problem. If you don't want your mouse cursor to get stuck at the edges of the screen, you should also capture your mouse cursor, for example, in the ready function. Finally, in the physics process hook, you'll want to make sure you're using the forward direction of the head node instead of the body itself to indeed have the player move relative to this look orientation. And that's it! You now have a basic FPS controller that can look around with the mouse, move based on this camera orientation, and even jump like our previous TPS controller before getting brought down by gravity. To wrap up this quick tour, let's talk about a third common type of 3D movement, the click-based navigation a la Diablo, for example. It's typically used in games where the camera is looking down at the character, because by definition, you need to be able to click on the terrain to tell your character where to go. Now, to do that in Godot, we can use what we call a raycast to transform our click points on the screen into a 3D target position in the world. In short, a raycast is an invisible ray that you cast from a given position in a given direction, and that can detect collisions with physics objects in your scene. So typically, in our case, if we put a navigation manager script on any node in our scene, we can use some built-in functions from the camera API to do a raycast from our screen to the ground, and get our move target position. Here I'm even using a custom physics layer to make sure I'm only clicking on the ground, so I put my ground static body 3D node on the matching physics layer in the editor. And so now, if we have a player with a simple third-person character controller like before, we can actually strip out all that is related to the inputs, and instead replace those with a target variable, and in the physics process, we compute our velocity depending on the difference between this target position and our current global position. We can also look at this position, and finally, back in our navigation manager, we just needed to use our raycast hit point as the target position for our player. Okay, so that's great. But of course, this only works well if we have a very empty room. Otherwise, simply going for our target point like this will simply have the player get stuck in the terrain and the obstacles. That's why usually we push this a bit further and combine this raycast-based targeting with an actual navigation system. In Godot, you can set it up like this. First, you put every scene element you want to be part of the navigation inside a navigation region 3D node. Then you give this new node a region resource and you bake it. This will instantly compute the walkable and unwalkable areas based on the meshes and/or the colliders of the hierarchy of nodes parented to it, and it will therefore give us the surface that our player will be able to navigate on. Second, we add a navigation agent 3D node in our player hierarchy, and we reference it in our player script. This way, rather than just using the target position as is, we can give it to our navigation agent to have it auto-compute the best path to this point, taking into account the obstacles on the terrain. Here I'm also going to ensure the 3D position we're targeting is in the navigation region, or else I'm gonna find the closest valid one on the navigation map. And so, there we go! With this simple raycasting and nav system, we've now got a super basic hack and slash 3D controller, entirely powered by a mouse. So in the end, you see that, thanks to Godot's built-ins, it's actually pretty easy to implement the most common 3D movement types in your games. But tell me, are there any special actions you'd like me to talk about? Would you like me to do a video on vehicle driving, or grappling hooks, or ziplines, or parkour? Again, don't forget that if you want to get the full demos of all these 3D movement types, you can check out my Patreon. Also, if you want to learn a bit about some crazy movement like teleportation, then you might want to check out this video where I tell you about how I remade Portal's famous mechanic. And yeah, feel free to tell me in the comments down below if you'd like me to keep going on that topic. As always, thanks a lot for watching, and take care!